taste of the eternal, taste of the eternal. I have started the leaves from the Sufi Heart Volume 3, which is being subtitled as Renaissance in Naqshbandi Tariqat, because Hazrat Mirza Mazhar Mir Jane Jana Razillah Ta'ala Unu, although he was in the tradition of Sheikh Ahmad Farooqi Mujaddidi Alif Sani Sarhindi, yet still there was a major shift in his way of teaching. And this was because of the fact that the political and the social circumstances were fast changing, and it has a serious influence on the tariqat. The intellectuals were running for shelters in madrasas and khanqa of the sheikh. The center of Naqshbandi tariqat shifted from Sarhind to New Delhi, to Delhi where Hazrat Mazhar Mir Jane Jana Razi Allah Ta'ala Unhu lived. It was a period of Renaissance. So it is subtitled as Period of Renaissance. Just as when we take a seed, the seed is known by its final fruition. It is called a rose plant because in the final analysis it brings the rose flower. A seed of a vegetable is known by its name because in the final analysis the fruit that comes on it is visible. In the same way, I am also revising the other volumes and then the other Sufi books, and on these I would like to request Rohit and Aisha to do their calligraphic arts, to write the Naqshbandi Kalmat. The volume 1, because it is pre-Naqshbandi era, it starts from Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq Razi Allah Ta'ala Unhu, when it was known as Siddiqiya, to Khwaza Ghaniya, which was Hazrat Ibn Khalid Ghizwani Razi Allah Ta'ala Unhu, and it was Hazrat Ibn Khalid Ghizwani Razi Allah Ta'ala Unhu who gave 8 kalmat. So one of that kalmat, I'll use it on the title written in calligraphic style, Nazar Var Kadam or Hosh Dardam. Then the volume 2 begins with the advent of Hazrat Shah Bahauddin Naqshband Razi Allah Ta'ala Unhu, and he gave 3 kalmat, Waqoof-e Adbi, Waqoof-e Jamni. So one of this will go on the title page of that. The third volume, which is Renaissance Naqshbandi Tariqat, it was an era where the Hindu influence began to filter more and more. And there is one of the most important sayings of Lalaji Razi Allah Ta'ala Unhu or Ramchandra, Betasubi Sadakat ki jaan hai. Betasubi means to rise above narrowness is the way to know truth. If you are tasub, your understanding of narrow in your understanding, narrow on the social ground, political, religious, caste, creed, then your understanding of truth is partial. So that statement will be most appropriate. Betasubi sadakat ki jaan hai. And because it is a communion of the two influences, the Islamic and the Hindu. So underneath, I like to use the Hindu symbol of Om, written in a calligraphic style. This is my intention, let thy will prevail. The other day when I spoke on Latifa, one question was asked. You mentioned that when one reaches to no mind, fana, enlightenment happens. These are the words to narrate the same thing. First, you move from mind to no mind. A state when there is no disturbance, there is utter silence, all the ripples have disappeared, the water of the lake is still, everything has dissolved. There is a state of utter relaxation, it is known as enlightenment. A simple way to understand this is, you as an ordinary student, you decide to choose a medical profession. Before you enter into the medical profession, your thinking, your way of life was one way. When you enter into the medical profession, your life began to change, your understanding, your thinking, everything began to change. Then when you had finished your degree, your lifestyle completely changed. You began to live by that understanding for which you spent 5 or 10 years. So after an enlightenment is not the end, it is the beginning. You have completed your education. Now you have to live by that. It is like the two shores of the river. The river is not the left and the right shore. River is not the river bed. First, the shores are formed. If you want to create a pond or something in your house, a piece of decoration, a little canal type, you dig the place, make it hollow. It has two edges on the either side. Between them is a bed is formed, and the water remains there. If it is a channel, it begins to flow. So neither the shores are the river, nor the bed is the river, nor the water, but it is sum total of all these things is known as river. River has a flow. So between these two shores of fana and baka, there is consciousness that never remains still, it continues to flow. It can be termed, if I have to use a way to explain, this is the river of enlightenment, river of life beyond, and you dwell in that continuously. So when you attain to that degree for which you have studied for 5 or 6 or 10 years, after that you are given an oath, and that is the part of the ceremony of graduation, that now I will live by this understanding. I will adhere to the principles in the same way. When you have attained to that, you begin to adhere by the principles of oneness. A master, a sheikh, a man of awakening does not make a distinction between his seekers. apparently it may appear that he is making a difference. He is prejudiced, but he acts according to the capacity of the individual seeker. Whatever is your inner capabilities, he allows those to develop. On this ground, it may appear there is a difference in his teachings. One child blossoms into one way, just as a gardener plants a garden, and wherein he plants many flowers, he takes care of the plants in the same way. One turns out to be a rose flower, the other turns out to be marigold, chrysanthemum, and so on and so forth. It all depends on the inner capabilities. So just as when you have finished your degree, you are allowed to plunder into the world to practice what you had been taught, you start practicing as a medical doctor or a lawyer or an engineer or an architect. This can be understood by the word bhaka. This is the state when one completes his inward journey. Earlier on he was living by his will. Now he begins to live by thy will. We have not seen the life of Jesus after he attained to resurrection. But whatever his life was, apparently Christianity does not speak of his life after resurrection. It ends at crucifixion. The resurrection aspect of Christ, which is the other shore, which is the bhaka, is not reflected in Christianity. It is a fact that both Moses and Jesus after resurrection, after crucifixion, when his body was brought down, it disappeared. And thereafter, rest of his life he spent on a particular place in Kashmir known as Pahalgam, the village of the shepherd, village of the sheep's shepherd. The two shrines are there, and the people who take care of, they are belong, that is an ancestral family. Nothing is known about that. He lived in wilderness after that. But one can live an active life and yet not be involved into the world. Many examples comes in. One example comes about the king Hazrat Ubaidullah Ahrar Raziyallahu Ta'ala Anhu. After he belonged, his father was king, Ubaid expressed the desire to follow the spiritual path. Father said, "You are my only son. I can allow you to go only on one condition. When I need you, you have to come back to me." Ubaid went in the company of Hazrat Father Muhammad, Hazrat Muhammad Zahid Raziyallahu Ta'ala Anhu. He spent number of years. After that, one day the message came, the father had called for him. It was his last time. Ubaid told Hazrat Zahid that I have no intention of being the king. He said, "Now is the time that you are belos. You are in the world, but the world is not in you. You have attained to the state of transcendence, a state of non-attachment. Now you can become the king." He continued to remain in the job. He will do his job. as if he is working for someone, carry on the kingly responsibilities. And afterwards, just as you go in the morning to do the work, you come back at a certain time, then you are a householder, spending time with your family, with your children and everything. So Ubad used to spend time in his solitaire, in his khilwat. And so one day, some of the fellow disciples, they ask Hazrat Qaza Muhammad Zahid, do you know anyone who is in the world and the world is not in him? So he told him, if you all happen to be in Airar, go and visit Ubaidullah. He is the king and yet still he is detached. So they have decided to visit him. On the way, when he came, was entering into the palace, he passed through the place where the horses were tied, and the pegs where the horses were tied, they were made of gold and silver. It's an ordinary thing you can have of wooden pegs, but a certain kind of decorum has to be maintained when you have a certain status. The palace has to be made in a particular way. It's not like an ordinary condominium or apartment. The deco and everything will be according to that. As they passed, a thought came to their mind. How can we be detached when even the horse, the pegs to tie the horses is made out of gold and silver? He was welcomed in the palace. Hazrat Ubad welcomed him, took care of them. And when the time came for meditation, he realized through his kashf there is obstruction in the flow of tawajjuh. Through his intuition, he looked and he found that those two pegs were creating the obstructions in the heart of those people. Then he looked at them and said, Hazrat, the pegs that you saw in this table, do you see the impression of these on the heart of this humble servant? Then they realize what is meant by this teeth. It is not that you do not, there are people who do not have an expensive car, but they aspire for it. They do not have an ostentatious living and they aspire for it. There are those who are living in it and yet is still not involved in it. That is a state of detachment. So the baka is that state. When you have attained to your degree, you have been given now permission to go and practice that, to live that way. This is known as baka. Then the Sheikh appoints, or God through the Sheikh appoints you to guide the humans. This is a state in which individual is part of the world, but unconcerned about his or her rewards or positions in it, is known as baka. After one attains to enlightenment, he has a freedom to choose one more life if he wishes so. And then he can choose his parents out of his own free will, for the continuation of the work that has remained incomplete in him. And that is the difference between fana and baka. It happened with Hazrat Baqiullah Raziullah Ta'ala Unu. One of his disciples asked him, what is the difference between fana and baka? He said, I cannot explain to you now, But the one who will do my namaz janaza when I passed away, you ask him. So this particular seeker kept that thought in his mind. But namaz janaza can be offered by only one, that person who has done, who has understood the tahajjud prayer. Because that is the hour when sheikhs meditate, they connect to the entire cosmos and they send their energies like a broadcast. Whosoever instruments are attuned, they come and receive it. How does this happen? In order to listen to this broadcast, which is available to everyone, the person must have the system, must have the internet connection, must have Skype downloaded, and must have been part of this group. It happened one day, Sheikh Brijmohan Lal came to stay in a particular place. So he was staying there. There was another Muslim person, and it was considered that the Muslims had lived their life at that time in a deep understanding. He had been there for 3 days, and after third day there was a knock at the door. Sheikh Brijmohan Lal said, look, Hakim Sahib came in. So when he came, he said, Hazrat, for the past 3 days I had been smelling the Naqshbandi Tariqat, but my kashf was not strong enough to know from which house, which place this fragrance was coming, which garden this smell of the flower was coming. That's why, excuse my audacity that I could not come to you 3 days before when you came. This is the connection. When you are attuned, you can feel the feeblest of vibrations. When a sheikh goes to a particular city, he looks towards and sends his energy field. Those who have their instrument attuned consciously or unconsciously in one way or the other, they come just like when a magnet is there. And with a strong magnetic field, all the metals begin to get attracted to the piece of magnet. This happens when one continues to do tahajjud prayer. This does not mean at that hour. That what is the significance is of that hour. From midnight to 3 o'clock in the morning. Hindus call it as Brahma Muhurt. Sikh religion, it is called Amrit Vela, the hour of nectar. It means the same thing. That is where the existence is available in its purity. And once you begin to connect to that, you can have your broadcast, and that is very important. So each sheikh does the prayer. During the time when we were growing, we were asked to do a particular chilla or particular zikr during that time. You go to sleep, get up 12 o'clock or 3 o'clock, and during that hour, you do that zikr or chilla and then go back to sleep. So it happened that Hazrat Baqiullah Raziullah Ta'ala Unhu passed away, and it was the time for his namaz-e-janaza. The person was looking out based on the message of the Sheikh. He saw a man garbed in a black garb appeared, and he offered the namaz-e-janaza and he disappeared. As he was disappearing, the seeker went, rushed towards him and held on to his arm from behind and asked him and stopped him. He said, "My Shaykh Hazrat Baqiullah Raziullah Ta'ala Unhu told me that one who offers his namaz janaza to ask him the meaning of fana and baka." By then the two came face to face with one another. The person who was in the garb, he removed the veil from his forehead. It was Hazrat Baqiullah Raziullah Ta'ala. The seeker asked, "What is this, Hazrat?" He said, "One whose namaz-e-janaza I went to offer, that was fana. And one who offered the namaz-e-janaza is baka. The difference between the two states is after fana, you can be in the body and yet be not in the body. You can move out of the body, the consciousness is free to leave the body, enter into another form, whichever form is available, that I had explained through the example of Sai Baba. Shirdi Sai, he allowed his consciousness to appear on the dog and the leper. Many times it happens with the master. One of the seeker of Sheikh Braj Mohan Lal, many such karamats. I will now call it as a karamat in a way to explain the difference between fana and baka, but these things were not mentioned like that. He had mentioned that, Sheikh, I wish when it is my last time, I want you to be with me. I want you to be with me. Sheikh Braj Mohan Lal was in the city of Fatehpur, and this person, Ram Gopal Mehrotra was his name. He lived in Lucknow. The distance between the two cities by train, it was of maybe a half day. It happened, it was the evening time. The meditation session used to take place. After he finished his official work, he returned from his office. Then around 7 o'clock or so, he will enter into meditation. A similar practice I have made. By 7 o'clock, I am finished of the day's work. After that, the time is available for the seekers, whosoever wants to connect to me at that hour. They can arrange and connect accordingly. A slight difference is because the seekers around me, they are in different time zones, in different spatial time. So it has to be connected in a different way. He was sitting down in meditation. Everyone has gone. Only one person was there. He said, all of a sudden, he said, "Mr. Ram Gopal Mehrotra is no more," and he closed his eyes. There, the family, it was the last time of the person Ram Gopal, and he saw, envisioned, not only he but everyone in the family saw the Sheikh Braj Mohan Lal came. He said, "Hazrat, this was my wish, that you be by my bedside when I am leaving. The breath is leaving the body." So he said, he blessed him and said that, "Now I am in a hurry. and after that details of the funeral service you will send it to me. Couple days after, a letter was received signed by his son, saying that on this date my father Ram Gopal passed away, and as was his last wish, Sheikh was there with him. When the letter reached to show wonder, this gentleman to whom Sheikh said that Ram Gopal is no more, he said he was sitting in the meditation with me and I was with him. With his opened eyes, he said that Ram Gopal is no more, and then he closed his eyes. After that, what happened, I do not know. What happened, his body was there, but his consciousness moved from there. And it manifested on whatever vehicle was available there. When a person begins to do this, it is known as bhaka. There is no equivalent for bhaka in English language as far as I have found it so far. And Sufism is the journey between fana and bhaka. Journey between fana and bhaka. The content of this morning's talk has no relevance with the topic that I spoke in the beginning, but just to connect to that, I will speak a little bit. Man is identified with body mind mechanism. Just as these two words, space and time, before Albert Einstein were considered as two separate words. But after his discovery of theory of relativity and his work, these two words became interconnected and the new term came into existence, spatio-time, with an understanding. In the same way, long ago, the body was considered separate, mind was considered separate. Body have five sense organs and five organs of perception, the subtle aspects. The one that gives you the awareness of taste, one who gives you the awareness of hearing, that is the subtle aspects. So mind is also considered as a sense organ, a mechanism. So it is one word, body, mind. They are interconnected with one another. It is not only that man is identified with body-mind realm, instead he considered himself as body. As long as you are identified with the body or the mind or body-mind realm, you cannot be aware. Awareness is beyond body-mind realm. Being in that state, you can have a theoretical experience or you may get fleeting glimpses of awareness, but you are not aware. You may know about these lataifs theoretically. You may know about fana and bhaka theoretically. You may know how to be in the world and be not allowed the world within you theoretically. You may know theoretically how to take the blood pressure, how to do the testing, but unless you qualify and you attain to that, you will not know. So you have to go beyond all that knowing, only then you come to the state of awareness. And without this awareness, your sex life will not transform. In that case, your energy will continue to move outward or downward. The process of bliss or fulfillment requires the energy to move upward through various psycho-spiritual centers. In the process, it fertilizes each center, and then ultimately the flower of love begins to blossom.